You're listening to One Free Family, a new take on peaceful parenting, where you can hear ideas for helping to raise free, independent, and peaceful children. Visit onefreefamily.com to connect and listen. Here are your hosts, James and Taylor Davis.
And we're back. It's another episode of One Free Family. This is James.
And Taylor.
And we are so excited to bring you, I guess, a part two-ish of last week's episode where we're trying to define a little bit more of what it means to talk about being a self-directed or unschooling family. Today, we're going to be diving a little bit deeper on what our real goals are in all of our connections with our kids. But before we get started, we'd love to thank BJ Mumford, our newest patron.
Thanks, BJ.
Yeah, we're so grateful for everyone who chips in to help support the show. Really helps a lot, especially for the folks behind the scenes that help make all the little wheels turn and engines motor or something to keep everything going. Taylor's laughing at me. It's hard being the host with the most, just so you know.
That's true. Yeah. I don't know, actually.
Keeping all the balls in the air. Right. Thank you. Exactly. But yeah, we are so grateful for everyone who has chipped in so far by going into onefreefamily.com/support to help us keep the show going week to week. So yeah, today it'll be really fun, I think, to dive in to what we really focus on in each interaction with our kids because, you know, we mentioned this last week, but unschooling in particular, a kind of broad label that's been used to describe the sort of lifestyle that we're developing here, is often defined as what it isn't, like we pointed out last week. It's not sending your kids to school. It's not having, you know, a hardcore curriculum that you follow each day at home. But what is it, right? I mean, last week we talked about how we try to work to develop a nutrient-rich environment around the house. If you haven't listened to this that episode, you probably should go back and listen to it. But I think this one can probably stand alone on its own as well. And once again, I think this one, even probably more so than last week, is going to be very relevant for you regardless of what your kids do from 9 to 5 each day.
Oh, totally. No matter how your kids spend their days, if they go to school, if they're home with you, if you do school at home more formally, you know, connection with your kids is going to be a part of your life no matter what.
Yeah, exactly. And I think also you're going to have tons and tons of interactions with your kids every day. And I think developing an intentional approach to what your goals are in each of those interactions will really help you, I think, do a lot of things. I think, first of all, it helps you define what success looks like in an interaction, right?
Right.
It helps you try to figure out why you're doing the things you're doing. And I think it helps you present a consistent worldview to your kids as to why you're parenting how you're parenting. Because I think a lot of, you know, it's a common joke meme sort of in parenting. Kids are always asking why. Well, they ask that because it's really useful to know why.
Right.
Especially when you're out of control of some of the things in your life or someone is telling you things that are hard for you to hear. Really having a deep understanding as to why they're doing the things they're doing really does matter. So, so I think the main thing that we're, the lens that we've cultivated, I suppose, that we've tried to develop for each of our interactions with our kids is trying to think about how we can build a stronger connection to them. Is that, would you say that's fair?
Yeah, I think almost everything that we do in our lives is kind of decisions are being made through the lens of connection within our family and all the relationships in our family. And will this next decision, you know, deepen our connection with our children or the child that we're working with at the moment, or will it chip away at that connection? So I think it really has become the lens through which kind of we do everything. And so I think in many of our episodes, we've kind of touched on that and talked about it a little bit, and you'll probably hear it come up almost every week because it's so big. But we really wanted to dive fully into it this week.
Yeah, and that's not to say that we'll never do anything that will cause tension or hard times between us and our kids. I think it's more to say that the question we ask ourselves first is, you know, say like, you know, when I used to work in summer camping, I called this initiating a point of tension, you know, and the idea being that your kid is in the flow of doing something, right? You're going to engage that child for some reason, really thinking about why you're engaging that child and to meet what goals, right? And so in the summer camping environment, you know, you have some kids and they're really focused on some activity, digging a ditch. I remember these one kids were doing. And the question was, well, is it really important to pull them out of this moment they're in because I have a goal for them to do a different activity,
right,
or isn't it? And this comes up in parenting, obviously in school, quite a bit. Then on the flip side, it's like these two kids are about to get in a fist fight. Do I want to pull them out of this moment and like break their flow of about to get? Well, of course I want to, you know, so maybe that in the moment they won't be like, wow, I feel so connected to James right now. He's like talking to me about why I shouldn't be in a fist fight. And I understand that there's going to be tons of times that come up where you're going to need to have hard discussions with your kids or with kids that you work with. But this is more talking about, you know, again, trying to move that line back. You know, can we scale back the times that we're
cut back on those times,
intervening in a child's life, or trying to redirect them or steer them towards something that feels more important to us and away from something that feels more important to them?
And this actually right now is making me, as I'm listening to you, James, it's making me think of kind of a common parenting phrase that is tossed around a lot, which is choose your battles or pick your battles. Mm. And I think this, the idea that we're talking about here today is almost, it almost is that, but taken with a much more, like, I think a really intentional, thought out approach to that idea. So I don't like the word battles because I don't like to think about being in battle with my children. I like to think about us as partners, but just the idea of like, of choosing really carefully and intentionally when we do think it's necessary to introduce some point of tension. And what I have found in my years of trying to focus more on this is that it's actually a lot, it's necessary a lot less often than I thought it was.
Yeah, I think, well, the whole idea of picking your battles is another thing actually I've written on in the summer camping space. And I think the time, and it's used, I think it's used at the wrong time.
Right.
Oftentimes this term comes up when you hear like, okay, a mom and a kid are at the playground, and the mom is like, or the parent, any parent in general, is like, no climbing up the slide. And the kid is like, I want to climb up the slide. And you're like, no, you can't climb up the slide. And the kid's like, but I want to climb up the slide. And then someone's like, and in that moment, you can pick your battles and be like, okay, well, I'm just going to back off here. I actually think the useful time to pick your battle is before you say something in the first place, right?
Oh, of course.
Because
of course.
I do think there actually is a lot to consistency around your expectations. And now, for me personally, I don't care if my kids climb up slides or not, unless they're at a place like, you know, say like one of those one-way indoor playgrounds where the whole point is to go around in a circle and you can only go down the slide or else you block everyone else. But so there are things that I don't want my kids to do, like hit other people, right? So before I go into that interaction, I know already that if I see my kid running up to some kid and hitting him,
you have a plan.
Yeah. I'm going to pick that quote-unquote battle already. I'm choosing that right now. And so when that happens, I don't need to have any self-doubt, like, am I being ridiculous right now? Because I think that's where the pick your battles thing comes in, where it's like you kind of went on a ledge and tried to restrict something. Now you're having second thoughts based on your kid's reaction, because maybe you weren't confident that not going up the slide was a good idea or not. Or, you know, maybe you weren't confident that they should have to share their toys with their little sister or whatever, right? And so, yeah, I think the picking your battles thing, the time to do that is like now when you're listening to the podcast.
Right.
And not
thinking
to say
about things that could come up in the future.
Right. And so some things will surprise you. You won't be prepared for every single moment. But I think this episode will potentially help with that too, because you won't be able to foresee every particular instance. But by starting by asking yourselves a few questions first, I think you can start to get a better lens for when you should be intervening and when you shouldn't be.
Yeah. And I'll also say, you know, so much of what we talk about, I think the focus is on why we're choosing what we're choosing, kind of because of the way we think it will affect our kids and what we want for our kids. I will just throw out there at the beginning of this episode that focusing on building connections with our kids, awesome side effect or bonus is that it actually feels really good for us too, as parents. It's so fun. And there's really like, there's nothing better than feeling connected to the people that you love. And so, you know, when we kind of started out on this journey, I never really expected how much it would kind of personally be so fulfilling as well. So just kind of a little plug there, you know, if you're feeling skeptical about some of the things we might say, just keep in mind too, that I think it could turn out to be a really beautiful thing for your own kind of personal journey as well.
Yeah, for sure. Actually, there's a book that, and I'm not hugely in love with a lot of the conclusions that the book puts forth, but the book Selfish Reasons to Have More Kids, Why Being a Great Parent is Less Work and More Fun Than You Think, by Brian Kaplan. This book, you know, I won't dive into all of the conclusions or, you know, kind of the methodology and a lot of the stuff that it puts forth. But one of the findings that I think I agree with intuitively, but I also think is pretty well supported, is that it's really difficult. Like, I think, you know, a lot of people's goals around parenting come around trying to control the situation and trying to go in and say, you know, basically selling yourself on a story that there are these levers I can pull in early childhood or teenage years or whatever that will equal my kid having a good career and a loving family.
I think that's what we're told. That's what our culture thinks parenting is.
Yeah. And it's strange for maybe people talking on a parenting podcast to say otherwise, because, you know, maybe you're listening to a parenting podcast because you want to know which levers you need to pull in order to ensure this, but there are no guarantees in anything you do in parenting that it will lead to any sorts of outcomes. And I think even a lot of the correlations that people draw, you know, it's the methodologies in drawing them are kind of specious in my mind. One of the things that this book puts forth and that I think, you know, research sort of seems to suggest across the board is we actually do have a lot of control over what our relationship with our kids looks like.
Right.
And developing a positive, you know, kind of cooperative relationship with people is just more fun.
Right.
And just about
so go back much to your more point, fun. Yeah.
It's just a lot more fun than developing a relationship based on struggle and kind of asserting your power over someone to get them to do the things that you think are best.
Yeah. It's actually interesting. The other day I was just, you know, I was just at home with the kids and James was up in the office working. And I don't know, everybody was kind of up to their own thing for a little bit. And I was thinking about, I got struck for a moment about my own mindset going, especially going into days when I know that James is going to be working all day and I'm on my own with the three kids. And I was struck by how different my mindset is than it used to be. Part of it also could just be because, you know, two of my kids are a bit older now and I'm not in like the super, super intense years of having like two toddlers. That felt really intense for me. But I think I have a mindset shift now after kind of these years of doing all of this work, which is, you know, some years back going into days of parenting alone, I felt overwhelmed and kind of ready, you know, knew that I was waiting till the moment that I wasn't on my own anymore and kind of worried about what the day would bring. How are we going to fill all of our time? And I don't really often, unless I'm really tired, I don't really feel that way anymore. And I think it's because I'm learning to let go of kind of the feeling of like the need to kind of control the whole day and how it goes and to make sure that I have exactly the right things for the kids to do all day. There's just so much more kind of ease, I think, and peace in our days when people can get up to the things they want to, and also when I'm more deeply connected with my kids. So it's kind of just, again, it's just really changed the whole approach that I even have going into my days with my kids.
Yeah, and I think it's worth, again, reflecting on the goals of each of those days and what you think you can cause to happen with various approaches, right? So if you go into a day, especially, you know, and this will be different for people who have their kids at home versus people who have their kids at school. But even say on the weekends or you know, if you have a teenager, how they're spending their time outside of school, right? It's easy to sit there as a parent and think, you know, try to help them build their resume, I guess, for the future.
Right.
And even if your kid is five, you'll see a lot of this impetus as well, where it's like you'll hear people say things like, if you learn a foreign language early, you'll be a lot better at it in the long term. Or, you know, kids who play an instrument from the time they're 4 years old tend to have a much more musical understanding in adulthood.
Right.
And it's like, on one hand, of course, you know, like a lot of the kids who are able to stick with playing an instrument when they're 4 years old have an interest in playing instruments probably. So they were probably going to have that musical understanding regardless. But in addition to that, a lot of people, I think, want to look after the fact and then draw the lines between, you know, especially small sample sizes. Like, I know this one guy who learned French at age three, and now he's like a French poet or whatever. And it's like, okay, like that's one example. And what about the broader examples? You know, what about people writ large? How well do parents and authority figures do at cultivating interests in people that they want them to have?
Right.
And I think the track record for that approach is extremely poor. This is another thing actually from Brian Kaplan's book, but Peter Gray has touched on this as well, where especially with things like, say, music lessons, I think this is a really common one. Parents who like music or who believe that developing a musical understanding, you know, because research has been put forth that suggests that understanding music will lead to all sorts of positive outcomes and whatnot. But some people have found an inverse correlation between an appreciation of music and being forced to do music lessons growing up. Some people have found that it's basically neutral. And, you know, some people have anecdotal evidence that suggests that it leads to a greater appreciation for it. But I think what we can take from all of that is that giving your kids music lessons, there's no evidence to suggest you're going to give them a happier life in the long term. And so, again, talking about connection, let's think about what that discussion looks like. You're like, hey, it's time to go and, you know, go off to your violin lesson now. How does your kid respond to that?
Right.
And I think that's the thing the question I would be asking myself, rather than telling myself a story of, well, if I just force them to do this, even if they don't want to, they're going to have a happier life someday, versus like, this person is using words to try to communicate something to me. How am I going to respond?
Right. And if that kind of sending them to the violin lesson because you think it's best for them is creating tension in your relationship and unhappiness in their life, that's where I would think twice, like you're saying.
Right.
You're, of course, going to have the kids who are going to say yay and grab their violin and run to the car because they love it. And then, you know, then you're supporting something that they're really interested in and you're deepening your connection at the same time by helping them get what they want. So,
yeah. And even sometimes I think there's a gray area here too, because I know I understand that not every parent is just going to say go for it to their kids on for all of their free time, right? But I think it's also, you know, there's, I think I've heard people say things like, well, I'd like my kid to be involved in something. I'd like them to get up to something. And if you're not comfortable with that looking like video games or playing outside with friends or whatever, maybe just more discussions around what that something could look like.
Right.
And if they're struggling, if you've got a list in your mind of acceptable somethings, be honest with your kids about that, I suppose. But if you're willing to listen and you're willing to kind of go deeper and work through the hard period of trying to figure out what these other things might be, understanding that your kid might not even have any idea what other options are available in the world, then I think that's a way to kind of scale it back a little bit and kind of put connection forward a little bit more than you would have otherwise.
Sure. And I would also say, I think you're right. That's something of like a middle ground. If you're not ready to kind of, you know, yeah, so let them just go whole hog. I would say too that if you're feeling like you want to experiment with letting them go whole hog, one really helpful first step is to try and learn what they love about what they are doing if you are kind of giving them that space. So really, really like authentically join in with them and what they're doing and try to figure out what it is about that thing that they love. Because I think that for me, at least, I've seen that when I am starting to question what my kids are getting up to or feel worried that I'm not, you know, giving them enough of a varied, you know, tray of things to choose from, or maybe I'm worried about how they're, you know, that their interests aren't going to lead to anything, I stop now and I realize that I'm mostly just feeling disconnected from them and I'm not really understanding what's making them tick or what's motivating them to do the things that they're doing. And that's when I really need to go like re-engage with them. I need to sit down with them and be really present and learn about what they're doing. And every time I do that, it's amazing to see, I realize how much I didn't know about what they were loving, because all of a sudden I'm seeing all these connections that they're making or these little ideas in a game that they're latching onto that's like setting their imagination on fire. And also when I do that and I go sit down and I get interested in what they're up to, it doesn't take long for them to just want to tell me everything about the thing that they're doing. And those conversations are so, so huge for kind of building our connection.
Yeah. And I think, if you think about people in your life, you know, so many people listening to this will have something that they're really interested in that not everybody is really interested in.
Right.
And you can always tell when you engage somebody about it, like you're really into knitting, for instance. Like knitting is not my thing.
Right.
Like that's not something I really care about very much. But if you knit and every time you're knitting, making offhand comments about how it's like a waste of time or, you know, how I just simply don't get it. Like,
yeah.
That's not going to feel good to you.
Horrible.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it would just feel like this person doesn't understand me at all. Like, I get that knitting is not their favorite thing, but like.
And I'm probably just like not going to come to them to tell them about things I'm interested in anyway at this point. Cause.
Yeah. Well, you just feel judged.
Yeah. Right?
And that's not a good feeling. And I think as an adult, it's very easy to understand how bad that would feel. But I think we also have a rightful understanding that no one should come and tell us what our interests and hobbies should be.
Right.
And our culture tells us that adults should tell kids what their interests and hobbies should be, in spite of how bad it feels. And so the question we would ask ourselves again is like, is this, you know, we think about that points of tension concept. Is that an area in your life where you hope to intervene to cause a better outcome? Do you think it's worth? Because what you're saying is, I know this is sacrificing connection right now.
Right, right.
Is it important to intervene? And you're going to hear a lot of people that are concerned about certain types of hobbies in particular, like watching shows or playing video games in particular. Those are two of the most demonized ones these days. And it's going to be hard, I think, sometimes to ask yourself that question. Like, is this a time where I should intervene or shouldn't I? Is this TV a silent killer that's going
to
dull my kid's mind or isn't it? And I think that actually is a really hard question. I think I don't want to go too deep on the screen time thing, because I think that's an episode
in
and of itself. But I think it is worth pointing, I think, back to Peter Gray on this one. And I think we may have mentioned this quote on a previous episode. And if not, now's as good a time as any, where he talks about children throughout history, you know, from hunter-gatherer cultures up until today, observing the tools of their culture and engaging the tools of the culture via play, right? And so kids will see us on our devices. They'll see that many people, adults work on computers. You know, they'll see all the different things that adults do. And in many ways, they'll model their play after how you play. And so, again, chances are good if you're not sitting around tickling the ivories and playing the piano at nighttime, that your kid might not pick up instruments as a matter of course. You know, like they will observe how you spend your time, and that will frequently be ways that they spend their time too. And I think that's also, it can be an exciting thing, you know, like you said, sitting down with a kid who's enjoying a show, even if it's something that you're not interested in, and asking them, hey, what's going on here? That can spark them, and a big smile and a long...
Oh, they love it so much. Yeah. Just this morning, actually, our middle son was downstairs with me, and we were just, I don't know, he's been really into Pokemon lately, and he was telling me about this one Pokemon character that he saw in a show in one of the episodes he was watching, about how it has like this fluffy fur around its neck, but it's also spiky when people attack it or whatever. And he was telling me all about it, and just, I think sometimes, I don't know, just being interested in what he was saying, you could just like see his whole face light up. And then he grabbed his iPad and found the episode that character is in, and he didn't even want to watch it with me. He just wanted to show me the picture of it on like the picture for the episode, so I could see what he looked like, because he thought I would especially really like this Pokemon. Oh. And there were other Pokemon in the picture, and he was telling me about how it's actually really the same one, but it holds a different stone and it evolves and like all this stuff that it's just, I could see like how the idea of what these Pokemon are and how they change and evolve and the different skills that they have and how they're controlled by the people. Like that story to him was so interesting. And he just loved being able to share that with somebody.
Right. But if he had an idea in his head that when mom comes around, she's going to imply that I'm wasting my time, then we've seen this because, you know,
which by the way, I've done in the past. I mean. Yeah.
And we've seen that instead of excitingly sharing what's happening and what's fun about it to him and what he likes about it, you know, helping you understand him more and helping connection grow and so forth, then he'll just kind of become closed down, or like maybe watch in an area of the house where you aren't, or, pretend like he's not watching and doing something else. Who knows what can happen there, right?
So I wanted to go back to what you said, James, about, you know, in the moment asking yourself, you know, is this thing I'm about to intervene on kind of more important than my connection with my kid? Mm-hmm. And I like that question, because I think that question scales to many different ages of kids too. And obviously, you know, I only know up to 7.5 years old, and there's a lot of parents who've been parenting this way for much longer than us, who I, you know, have great resources out there that I turn to for, you know, looking ahead to the future. But I would have to guess that this would scale really well even into later parenting years. Just thinking about, you know, teenagers and things like that, I think there will be some situations where perhaps intervening will be more important than my connection, if that makes sense. You know, there's going to be some really, really big life decisions that are made. Again, I think it might be intervening less than we might think we need to, but I really do think there will be times when I really do need to intervene. And I think that does scale to older kids, and it really helps you think at each moment, you know, okay, this is actually a moment where something super unsafe is about to happen, and I think that I need to put a little bit of our connection on the line right now so I can intervene.
Well, I'm not even sure you are putting connection on the line.
Maybe not at that point.
Once your kid has become of that age. And I think also, as your kid especially gains more bodily autonomy, like if they have a driver's license or whatever, any intervention that you might think that you're capable of might just be an illusion anyway, right?
Yeah,
like,
for sure.
How many parents try to, quote unquote, intervene against their kids experimenting with alcohol or marijuana or something like that, right? And they're telling themselves a story that they prevented that behavior, and what they've really done is driven it underground, right?
Yeah.
And I think if that's the type of behavior that you're really concerned about, I actually think this approach really prioritizes your ability to persuade your kids to listen to you in those big moments, you know, because if you spend most of your time, and I have a story about this actually from the summer camping time with teenagers in particular, but if you spend most of your time just connecting with people and showing them that you are trustworthy and showing them that you are interested in them, and that you're basically, you spent all of your time listening to them and, you know, hearing what they like and respecting it, even if they can see it's not totally your thing. And then very occasionally you step in and say, "Ooh, I'm not totally comfortable with this right now." That will stand out as different than your other interactions.
Right.
I think this goes to the idea, another saying you hear out there, to go back to those, is that don't be a friend to your kids, right? And people mm-hmm. picture what being a quote unquote friend to your kids looks like. And they think like, ooh, it's like the mom that shares, you know, sexual war stories with her kids something. I don't know what people think when they, you know, they're picturing like the dad who goes in there and, you know, just, I don't know, tells their kids about things that are inappropriate or makes inappropriate jokes. I don't know what the actual being a friend to
what the fear is.
Yeah, exactly.
Kind of,
but that is a thing you'll hear, right?
You can't
be
the
their
time.
Friend first.
I'm your parent, not your friend.
Exactly. Yeah. I'm your parent, not your friend. That's actually probably more the saying than what I said. I don't use that saying very often, so it doesn't really resonate with me. But I think people say that, and what they're trying to say is if you create a friendship with a child, then they won't respect you when you need to
And then
to
you
intervene.
Can't control their behavior.
Right, exactly. Yeah. And I think there's so many inherent flaws in those assumptions that really will cause people a lot of problems. And so I've actually gone to the extreme in the other direction in my camping work, which is to say, and I teach my counselors to do this too, which is to say, go crazy becoming somebody's friend before you have any reason to intervene with them, right?
Yeah.
And this, by the way, works with kids from the hardest areas and the hardest lives possible. Uh-huh. It works with, you know, privileged kids and every kid in between, in my experience, because it's so different than how they're used to being interacted with in every other aspect of their life, that when you come in and say, hey, I've got no agenda, I just want to be friends, you know, I just want to get to know you. And then if something concerning does come up and you have to go there, then I found that people really listen. So the story I teased earlier, we were running camp, and this is one of the first years we were really running it in a freer way, you know, giving kids more space to do exactly what they wanted, with whom they wanted, when they wanted. And a counselor rushes in at like 10:30 at night, and she's breathless and concerned and says, hey, some of the teens have snuck out. You know, and I was like, oh man, that's not very safe. We're on this 800 acre property. It's dark out.
Yeah.
They might get lost. You know, so I feel very concerned in this moment. We go out, we find these teenagers who had snuck out to a central bathhouse to chat, you know, because we had the boy camper sleeping in one area and the girl camper sleeping in the other. And I say, hey guys, like, I see you guys are out here. Why don't we talk and figure out what's going on? So we go back to one of our rooms and we all sit down in chairs, and I can tell they're all ready to just hear me jump into them. One girl is on the verge of tears. I think she's worried we're going to call mom
her parents,
or send her home or kick her out, because she's the type of person who doesn't normally break the rules, you know. And I started by saying, hey, I just want to say sorry, because it's obvious that you guys have a greater need for time spent with one another than we're providing. And you're willing to break what few rules we have here in order to get it. So I can see this is really important to you. What can we do? How can we brainstorm together to help get you the connection that you're looking for, while also keeping my need of having a safe environment for everyone intact? Because I can tell you that your parents didn't send you here, and they didn't, when they're entrusting us with you so that you're not running around in the dark on a property you don't know very well to get lost or injured or whatever, you know, fall in a hole somewhere. And they listened, you know, they said, wow, like, we didn't think about how scared you would be and that kind of thing. And so we just came up with a new solution. Okay, well, every night we'll try to carve out an hour where you all can sit and chat and hang out with each other. We won't eavesdrop on your conversations, but we'll have a counselor present so they can see where you are, so we can honor that agreement we've made
that
to your parents.
Supervision,
you know?
Agreement.
Yeah, exactly. And they were totally understanding in that. And that was a huge trust builder. And, you know, those kids, I didn't have them for very long in my charge as a person at camp, but many of them came back year after year. And a couple of those kids in particular wind up sharing huge things that were going on in their lives with us. And one of them in particular actually cited, she remembered back to that moment of, I remember when you caught us sneaking out, and I just know that you really care about us, right? And so I think it makes a huge impression on kids when you show them that kind of like radical consideration of their needs.
Yeah.
And I think starting from a place of empathy and starting with your own kids of, instead of you shouldn't be doing this, instead of trying to say like, I see that you have a need for something that we're not providing.
Yeah, that deep, deep empathy, trying to really get into their shoes and figure out what's going on.
Because sometimes you might guess wrong. You know, you might say, hey, it seems like you have a need. You know, like the classic would be, you know, the one kid is nagging the other. Hey, it seems like you want someone to hang out with you or pay attention to you right now. And the kid says, no, I don't. I just want to use the Xbox.
Right.
You know? It gives them when you're trying to demonstrate that you understand how they're feeling, it gives them an opportunity to say, hey, you've got it all wrong. Actually,
right. And then they can tell you how they're feeling.
Yeah. And that again builds connection, because if you just run in and say, hey, I know you just want all the attention right now, let your brother focus, you know, you might just erode the connection and opportunity and create someone to or create a feeling in someone where they feel misunderstood,
yeah,
rather than giving them an opportunity to explain themselves, you know?
Yeah. And I think that this brings up a really important point, which is I really think that every situation, even like the toughest situations that we sometimes are confronted with and we wish we could just run away from them and hide, every kind of situation is an opportunity for connection and also learning. And even if it's a situation in which we do kind of feel like it's important that we set a boundary of some sort or have some conflict that happens within that situation, I think connection can still come out of it.
Yeah, or at least less of it can be taken away than possible. Like, you can always optimize better for connection.
Even in the hard situations.
Right, absolutely. Because sometimes, like, you know, say two kids are in a physical fight with one another and you come in and you like kind of break it up or whatever happens. They might not feel like, ooh, I feel so connected to that person.
They might not right away. Because
their adrenaline
is
pumping. Yeah. They're, you know, really caught up in this moment of, you know, hard feelings and so forth. But I think that there are ways to nuance those interactions in such a way that when they think back on it, maybe even if it's years later, they can think, oh, I see that that person wasn't acting arbitrarily, that they were.
Right. Well, and really I think there's, in a lot of these situations, we can't forget that there's follow through that happens, right? So yeah, in your example of the kids who are about to get into a physical altercation, no, they may not feel super connected. I mean, clearly neither of them is feeling a deep sense of connection to anything in the moment. But when you stop them, no, they may not be like, oh gosh, this guy's great. But typically, there's going to be follow through that happens after that.
And hopefully.
Yeah. Well, right. Ideally. And that follow through can often actually help to build connection. I really do think that it can. It might still be really hard and it might not be immediate, but that those conversations and the work that happens after that can actually, I think, contribute towards deeper connections.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think connection also goes two ways, right? And I think part of having a connection with someone isn't always. Because I think for a lot of people, this kind of triggers an alarm that says, like, hey, are they saying that I should never consider my own needs when it comes to a kid? Or I should never talk about my own feelings and it just should be all about what the kid wants and whatever? I don't think that's the case. I think that part of a real connection between two human beings is when people can honestly state their needs and feel understood themselves, right? And so, you know, like a classic one that I think comes up sometimes is like chores or helping out around the house, right? We don't really force our kids to help out around the house for the most part. I mean, other than maybe if they create like some huge mess.
I still wouldn't say we force because you can't force.
Obviously, we don't take their hands and scrub right. up the mess or anything. But, you know, we would state very strongly that we would hope we'd have some help in cleaning it up or something. But I think when we really think about our goals in any of those situations, again, my major goal is to feel understood. So take doing the dishes, you know, you or I do 99.9% of the dishes in our house, except for the one time where Ali emptied the dishwasher for you at nighttime because you asked him nicely to. But our kids do bring their dishes from the table over to the sink, right? And they do that, I think, primarily because we've stated that that's a big help. And they see they like spending time with us. They like when we have time to do the things that we enjoy, they, I think, are able to acknowledge that. And we've said, hey, you know, like it would be a big help. You're walking in this direction anyway. Do you think you could bring this over for us? And our kids, I think they have an understanding without a guilty feeling that we are the ones who do all of that work to clean up.
Right.
And so, well, yeah, they're short. They're not going to stand up and even physically be able to wash the dishes without great effort for themselves. But they know that that is something that happens. And they know that, like, you know, our needs around getting things clean are important. And they can kind of understand and validate that for us too.
Yeah, because when you think about connection, it's not really a good, healthy connection unless both people's needs are considered and at least heard. So I think a lot of conversations in our house, especially when we're experiencing conflict, like maybe conflict about two people wanting to use the same thing or people wanting to spend their time differently, a lot of the conversation revolves around like, well, let's give each person time to share what's most important to them right now. What are your needs? What are your needs? Okay, here's my needs. Is there a creative way that we can do our best to meet everyone's needs over time? And so we're kind of building connection by really hearing everybody and also helping them to see that we are people who also have needs and sharing our own needs. And then we're kind of brainstorming around those needs to find solutions.
Well, I think that's actually a huge takeaway that folks can have if you're from any, you know, walk of working with kids, which is that when you collaborate on solutions to tension and, you know, points of conflict, mm-hmm. it yields such better results than if someone just rushes in with a solution, right?
Definitely.
It helps so many things happen, right? So say in the instance of two kids arguing over the Xbox, if an adult runs in and says, well, here's what's going to happen, there's very likely going to be a feeling of resentment coming from the parties who are, you know, being handed down this ruling, right? Because maybe they just had totally different goals. You know, maybe one had already taken a turn for 15 minutes.
Right, and you just didn't know.
You don't have any context. I think it's very easy to seem like you're acting unfairly, even if you have come up with the fairest solution, if you're the one that comes up with it. Because especially when people are arguing, they feel very passionately about something. And even if the solution presented helps them get their way, I think it's pretty likely for them to not feel totally considered versus the approach that you suggested, which is to come in, maybe suggest that everyone take a pause from what they're doing and try to work out a solution.
Because right.
And observing, like, hey, I can see that this process of finding a solution isn't working out too well. Are you guys open to a different path towards right. trying to solve this? And I think in most cases, again, if your kids or if the kids you're working with view you as credible, they will pause for a second and listen.
Right, right.
And yeah, so as we're thinking, yeah, go ahead. You had something else?
You can go.
You lifted your finger.
I did.
Like you wanted to say something.
Well, I was just thinking, I'm kind of going in a different direction.
Yeah,
is that
perfect.
Okay? I was just thinking about maybe we could talk for just a couple minutes about if there's people listening who feel like they're in a place where their connection with their kids is not where they'd like it to be. Mm-hmm. Like, what are some maybe ideas that we might have that they could kind of start using right away to help rebuild that connection? Because I think that maybe some people listening might be thinking like, well, I wish I really was more deeply connected to my kids. Or I know for me, sometimes I go through phases where I feel like maybe I've lost a little bit of connection with one of the kids or something. And there's kind of little things that I think, depending on your personality and your life, that you can do to start rebuilding that connection. And
yeah,
that could be, so maybe just some helpful ideas. Do you have anything to
go first? Let's jump in.
Too. Yeah.
So I think for a good place to start, and this is just something to keep in mind that will make this process a lot more likely to succeed, is that if you are having a struggle with connecting with your kids, you won't be able to fix it in a day. You won't be
right.
able to walk up and say,
yeah.
hey guys, good news. Now I want to focus on connection.
Right.
And I'll say, yeah, dad wants to focus on connection and like welcome you right into everything. And I think it's easy, you know, to be so zoomed in on any given moment and feel defeated if it doesn't work right away.
Yeah.
And so I would start by saying that building connection, building relationships with people takes a really long time, and people are very much creatures of habit. And if you already have certain habitual interactions with somebody else, it takes a while to unravel those. And so give yourself time, give
yourself
grace,
yeah.
and also don't resent your kids if they don't respond right away. Cause it's tempting to, you know, I've heard parents say things like, oh, well, I tried my best and they still didn't care or something, right? And it's not really the case in most cases that they didn't care. It's just that they're not ready to just slip right into a new habit just yet.
Yeah, it takes a long time to build trust and connection, especially if it has been chipped away at or damaged at all.
Yeah, big time. So what do you had some practical things
you
wanted to
jump into? Well, I think the first one that came to mind is just, in listening to you talk a little bit, James, is just empathy. So in terms of, you know, anything that happens, that you can kind of formulate a plan in your mind before the next conflict, right? Or before the next potential point of tension, and kind of pep talk yourself into starting with empathy. And I think that sometimes if we can really, really focus on that, we can have a much more peaceful interaction overall. So, you know, kind of in thinking about being ready for the next potential conflict, kind of getting yourself ready to just first empathize with your kid. So have some questions ready to ask your kid, you know, you seem upset. Are you feeling upset right now? And give them a chance, like James was talking about, to actually say how they're feeling, right? Because they may say, well, I'm not upset. I'm really, really angry, or I'm really frustrated. So kind of, I think just putting yourself trying to join that conflict in a more open, receptive place where you can really empathize. Because I think if you can truly connect to the way that your kid is feeling, you can have a more productive kind of conversation about it. So that would be one of my thoughts.
Yeah, it's great. Yeah, I got one. Go ahead. Why don't we go back and forth? We'll play
I think I should just say them all.
Yeah, that makes sense too. We could just do ping pong. yeah, so I think the one, and you distracted me with your joke.
I'm sorry.
That's okay. All right. So I think another one for me is observing your kids' sort of like body language or their behavior around whatever it is they're doing. But when they give you an opening to be involved in something, like say your kid comes down to watch a show in a public area of your house. You know? Like I wouldn't barge right into your kid's room and be like, hey, I know I said I didn't like your girlfriend, but mind if I hang out with you guys now and like become friends with her? I think better is your kid comes down into that public area to watch and, you know, maybe you've offered judgment. You've said like, oh, this show looks stupid. Or like, why do you watch this stupid show? Or even if you said, why do you watch this? What do you
Right.
But maybe you come in and you just sit there with your own thing and you just start by being present. Yeah. Right. And it's, you know, it's kind of a baby step, but you come in and you've got your knitting in your case.
Right.
And they're watching their show. And then something happens that you don't understand. And you say, who's that?
Yeah.
You know, or just like a little bit, or, you know, they're playing video games in a public area in your house. And again, you come in and you're watching and you can tell something's intense and you say, hey, what's that? You say, oh, that's the bad guys. You know, we're going after them. Right. But just start with that little olive branch, that little part where you come around and be present. Their expectation is it's because you're going to say, hey, it's time for dinner.
Right.
So shut that off. But instead you're just there and you can kind of catch people off guard with that level of interest. And, you know, again, it doesn't have to be some grand overture, but just a little start small, I guess is my suggestion. Just show up, be present. And when the opportunity arises organically, ask an authentic question.
Yeah. And I think that focusing on doing that, those moments will start to build for your kid and they may not even consciously realize what's happening, but I think it will start to, you know, among, you know, having the rest of your interactions working on those, I think it starts to just turn into a different feeling that they have when they're around you. They're starting to feel more open and more receptive.
Yeah, for sure. And so I think if you can get past that initial step and you can have those kind of initial seeds laid, after that, I think really reconsidering your priorities around the home. So you may have, and I think another big acknowledgement here is that you may have been emphasizing things that are no longer feel as important to you because you're reflecting on the fact that you have this kind of like eroded connection. And so say around like maybe you have people do the dishes every single night. And for whatever reason in your family, this is always something you guys argue about. Right. And you just know like sure as clockwork, 7 p.m. comes, it's time to argue about doing the dishes.
Right.
I think it's totally okay to reset your own mind and say, okay, for me now, connections are just more important than having help with the dishes.
Yeah.
Right. And going to the kid and saying, hey, I noticed that we're arguing about doing the dishes so much, I think, and it's just explaining your perspective.
Yeah.
You know, for me, I work really hard to make sure I feed people and that we have healthy food to eat and, you know, we have a house is secured and I try to get, you know, you ready for all the stuff you need for school tomorrow or whatever it is that you're focusing on. And so for me, I think in my mind, I was just really hoping for some help with all of the tasks I have. And this seemed like something that would be a good fit for you to help out around the house.
Yeah.
I've noticed that you've really hated it. And I want to say like, you know, for me, I felt like it was so important.
Right.
And now I'm thinking that it's not as important to me as it was in the past. And I would really love to just like argue with you less about stuff.
Right.
But I still do have a need for help around the house. So maybe like in the next like week or so, maybe if you could think about if there are some ways where you might want to chip in that would feel like less burdensome for you or less, you know, less bad. But, you know, still, again, acknowledging that your needs are important and valuable and not letting them quote unquote win or, you know, get one over on you, but also communicating to them that you've seen how hard it is for them. Because I think sometimes, especially when we are asserting ourselves over children, it's never acknowledged that it's hard for them.
Right.
Or and teenagers
it's so hard
too.
For them. Yeah.
It really
is.
I mean, the reason they're fighting back is because they hate it probably.
Yeah.
Right. And so again, sometimes it's worth it. Sometimes it's worth saying like, yeah, no matter how much you don't like it, like you just can't beat your little brother up, you know,
right.
Like that's not working for us in our family, versus like, okay, this dishes thing isn't working out. Right.
Yeah.
But owning your own role in it and, acknowledging their feelings, I think even if for those hot button issues that you always seem to argue about, resetting yourself and coming clean and
totally
not even apologizing, that can be very disarming for someone who's ready for a fight.
Yeah. I have, you just said not even apologizing. Actually, one of my other suggestions, and I know we're kind of probably coming close to needing to wrap it up, but one of my other suggestions is, you know, like when you're feeling like your connection is a little bit eroded with one or more of your kids, I think conflict happens more often. And something that I have gotten better at and I'm still not great at is just if I feel like I have done something that I wish I hadn't done, just apologizing to my kid. You know, I think sometimes I feel scared to apologize because then obviously it's admitting that I was wrong and that feels really bad. But I think simply just knowing that it's actually okay to just say, oh my gosh, I'm so sorry. Like, I got frustrated and impatient there, and I kind of spoke in a way that I don't hope to speak, and I'm really sorry. You don't have that. That's all you need to do. And sometimes that can just reset the situation a little bit. And it just models also just models the idea that we're human and we make mistakes, but we can also apologize for them.
Yeah. Again, it gives kids a more consistent worldview, you know, because if we try to raise them in such a way where we're never wrong and they're always wrong, that's not actually true.
Right.
You know, sometimes regardless of how young your kid is, they're going to have a perspective on something that, you know, perhaps is more fair, more consistent than you someday. And that's okay. It doesn't mean you failed to apologize. And I think if we're hoping for kids who understand what apologies are and understand when they're appropriate, doing them when we've made our biggest mistakes,
sure,
or, you know, overstepped our bounds most egregiously, which again, we all will get frustrated sometimes,
yeah,
including you and I, Taylor. And I think that's okay. It's okay to just come and say, I really messed that up. I really wish I don't, for whatever reason, I wasn't ready for how frustrated I would be when I saw you guys arguing. So I yelled and, you know, or I ripped the controller out of your hand, or,
yeah,
you know, whatever I did that I shouldn't have done. And I'm sorry.
Yeah, exactly. I would also, I have so many ideas. Oh my goodness.
Let's start with one.
Well, I also think that, so in my head here, I was just thinking, you know, another way that I think is, can be really, another thing that can be really great for building connection is just genuinely having a really good time with your kids. So, you know, going and doing something really fun, or I think also sometimes getting really physical can be really fun if your kid is into that, whether it's like running around outside or wrestling on the floor. A lot of ideas actually in this book called Playful Parenting by Lawrence Cohen that we can link to. So I was starting to think about suggesting that, and then also realizing again that, like, if you're in a place where you feel like your connection really is hurting right now, that actually might not be the place to start. The place to start, I think, is kind of what James said, is just kind of joining them quietly in their things and building that trust again. So I think what I also want to say about kind of sitting down and joining them and doing what they're doing is, if that feels scary to you, especially if you're joining them in doing something that, like, you're not sure is the best thing for them, kind of just give yourself a time frame and tell yourself, like, I'm going to put all expectations of myself and my kid aside for the next 15 minutes, and I'm just going to sit down here with them and be with them and fully focus on anything I can do that's just going to build our connection. But I have found in the past, especially when I've been worried about the actual activity or whatever, that giving, this might not be right for everybody, but giving myself a little time frame has just kind of helped it feel less scary. I don't know if that makes sense, but just being like, I'm just going to sit here for 15 minutes with my kid, and I'm going to let go of any fears that I have about the way they're spending their time or any worries I have about our relationship. I'm just going to let it all go for 15 minutes, and I'm just going to focus on the connection. And then when that 15 minutes is up, if I had something that I needed to get done that I was worried about, I can get back to it. And I don't know, that just, that end point, especially when I was first working on this, it really helped me. And then I was able to just keep doing that more and more often until it started becoming more of like my regular way of being with my kids. It just made it less scary for me. In those moments also, this is a suggestion that I've heard from other unschooling parents, especially when I'm feeling disconnected with my kids, is I also was starting to remind myself of, like, recalling all of my favorite things about my kid during those times. Because obviously we all have things about our kids that we love so much that are our favorite things about them, whether it's, you know, the cute way that they sit when they're watching their TV show, or their little habit of twirling their hair with their finger, or their, you know, their love of stories, like whatever the things are about your kid that you especially love in those moments that you're trying to reconnect with them. If you can kind of hold those in the front of your mind, I think it just helps soften us with our kids. And
yeah, for sure. Yeah. I think those are all really excellent suggestions. I think I have one more.
Okay.
And then we can get going, unless you have another one.
No,
and then
I'm
just
good.
Keep going
I'm
for
good.
5 hours. So I think my last one, and I think this comes back to actually to another kind of fear a lot of people have about this parenting approach around trying new things. You know, will my kid try new things if I don't intervene or, you know, kind of steer them towards new things? I think this comes from a lot of parents who also inherently have a fear of trying new things when those new things are the things their kids do. And I think you talked about, you know, being playful with your kids and, you know, inviting them into play with you. I think going in and trying to do the things that your kids do, even if you're going to really suck at them, can really mean a lot to them. You know,
like, totally.
Like we've seen, and you know, as long as, and if you can have sort of a, not even self-deprecating, but be willing to like laugh at yourself when you go in and you have like a 5-year-old who's insanely good at some video game or even just like fine at it. And you go in there and you can't steer the car and it's like stuck against the wall. And, you know, like you're trying to figure out how, you know, how to make Mario get past the first mushroom guy without dying or whatever. And you laugh about it and you're like, oh my gosh, look at me. Daddy's cannot figure out how to get past the guy. And everyone's laughing. And then that does a lot of things. First of all, it brings laughter, which is almost always amazing.
Healing for sure.
Yeah. And it also puts the child in the position of being the teacher, which I think also furthers connection because
definitely.
When they can show you like, oh, well, here's the thing. Like you have the controller upside down or like, you know. Yeah,
here's
this is
a little
hard.
Tip, yeah.
In Minecraft. Oh, okay. Yeah, you want to start by, like, Minecraft is a funny game for this because, you know, you can do anything or nothing and everything in between. But the kid can come and say, oh, yeah, no, you need to make some armor. Let me show you how to, you know, chop down the tree and make the crafting table and whatever else. But it feels really good to be in that position of teaching.
Yeah.
And so not only it puts them in a really fulfilling position because, especially if it's like a younger kid in your family, maybe they're not often in the position as a teacher. But it goes even further than that. It shows them, oh, my parent was willing to go in here and try something that they're really not good at and make themselves vulnerable and laugh. You know, you're able to model trying new things for your kids in a healthy and open-minded way. And so there's all these benefits to coming in. But if you sit there thinking like, oh, I'm just not a video game person. I'm just like not going to understand this. Like video games are just games that are on a certain kind of device. Like there's nothing different about them than like playing Monopoly, actually.
Right. Just,
there's a different set of mechanics. But if you approach it with that kind of like beginner's mind and, an ability to laugh and smile at yourself and do that, I think that actually, whether it's video games or, you know, whatever, you know, Beyblades is another kind of game, like just whatever game your kids play.
Or I would say for me, soccer, like both of my boys really love to go outside and play soccer. And I played some sports as a kid, but never soccer. And I consider myself to be pretty bad at soccer, but I'm almost always up for a game, even though I know that I'm just not very good.
Right, so. but that doesn't, your kid doesn't care how good you are.
No, they That's don't. They want you to play with them.
You know, as adults, if we don't do work on our own baggage and we don't say like, oh, I feel self-conscious when I'm bad at things.
Right.
And we go in and we're like, oh, I'm just going to be the worst person in this soccer game. Maybe you will, but it's okay to be worse than a 5-year-old at soccer.
Right.
Like,
it's
that
fine.
Doesn't make you a bad person, actually. Right. It probably makes you an awesome person that you're willing to do things that you're worse than a 5-year-old at, you know?
Yeah.
I think I actually, when I think about people, I like to spend time with the person I want to be. I want to be the type of person who's willing to try things that even children are better than me at, because the world is going to keep changing and keep evolving. And I want to be ready to keep stepping in and being terrible at things that I might hope to be good at someday.
For sure.
Anyways, I think that seems like a reasonable last word to sneak in there.
Yes, a long one.
Yeah, that was a 4-minute last word. We have the timer up in front of us. But yeah, thanks so much for everyone for tuning in.
Yep, thanks so much for taking this journey with us. And just remember, each moment is a fresh opportunity to be the parent that you want to be.
Yeah, love you guys. See you next time.
Bye.
Thank you for listening to One Free Family. If you enjoy the podcast, please show your support by becoming a patron at onefreefamily.com/support. Your support will help make this show better. Plus, you can get access to rewards and additional episodes by joining. Again, that's onefreefamily.com/support. This has been a Pax Libertas Productions podcast.